One of Shestov's early works, a short work, is called The Theory of Knowledge, and it consists of 14 passages, some longer, some shorter, all focused on particular themes and talking in large part about the history and the current condition of philosophy in his own time. And I think that despite some things being a bit dated, you know, for example, his focus on neo-Kantianism as the dominant school, at least in European philosophy at the time, much of what he has to say is timeless, and or at least applies just as well to the late modern era as it does to his own early turn of the century time. And there are a number of different themes running through the work, and I put three of these up on the board: the history of philosophy versus philosophers, theories of knowledge versus truth, the experience of the truth, the reality of truth, and deductions and teaching versus actual philosophy, the activity of doing philosophy, the practice of doing philosophy. And I'm going to keep coming back to these themes over and over again, but I wanted to sort of signal them at the beginning and talk a little bit about each one in summary, because what we're going to do after that, after I bring up just a very few particularly striking quotes, is go through this essay section by section by section by section. And I will skip over a few things, but I'm going to try to touch on as much as I can, because it's a very rich and fertile essay. So, history of philosophy versus philosophy. By the time that Shestov is thinking and writing, there is already a discipline of the history of philosophy. And by discipline, what I mean is that there are people actually writing books called the history of philosophy. Windelband is somebody who he talks about in other essays, and Windelband was a very representative kind of thinker. He wrote a history of philosophy, and in it you have this progression that takes place. And I would say that in large respect, Kant and then Hegel are the people who really set the scene for doing a history of philosophy in the way that he's thinking about. Kant saw the history of philosophy as largely a history of errors. And the problem was these philosophers are addressing these fundamental issues, the really big questions. What is reality itself? What access do we have to reality? Can we know anything for certain? You know, how should I behave? What is the good or the goods? And what is a human being capable of? Is there a God? Is there not a God? What kind of relations can I have? And the philosophers seem to be all over the map with respect to this. So they're providing different answers. And this is not a new issue. I mean, if you look at Cicero's dialogues, what he does is he typically says, all right, well, we've got a Stoic, we've got an Epicurean, we've got a Skeptic, or we've got an Aristotelian. What answers are they giving? They're varying from each other. Can they argue, you know, for or against the positions, the dogmas that they're holding, the systems that they're developing? What arguments can they provide? And then, you know, which do we find convincing? On another note, a little bit later than Cicero, you have the satirist Lucian, who knew his philosophy and knew his philosophers, and manages to put them in, you know, places like dinner parties or arguments with each other or even the law courts. And he has them present their sides, and there's this experience of disparity, of not being on the same page intellectually about saying different things about these fundamental issues. So Kant looks at this and he says, yeah, I mean, this is a big problem. These guys can't actually agree about anything. And yet there are other disciplines that we see rising, the sciences in particular, and mathematics, where consensus at least looks like it's possible. So what the hell's going on with philosophy that's not happening? Well, they must have made mistakes in the way that they approach things, so you have to have the Copernican shift that Kant talks about, from thinking that the truth is out there to seeing truth as, at best, something that we are finding in the way that we've projected our categories or the forms of sensibility, or you know, other things, onto this ultimately unknowable chaotic reality. Hegel is the antipode to this. Hegel is sort of the counterposition. With Hegel, he grabs the Kantian bull by the horns and throws it. And the way that he's able to do this is by saying, well, there is progress made in the history of philosophy. Each of these thinkers is, if they're not just a dead end, they are actually advancing the question, advancing the inquiry a little bit, and perhaps thinking that they've found the final solution when actually they've only found a provisional solution, which gives rise to another one. And this is how you get the, you know, the thesis, antithesis, synthesis thing that's been caricatured so many times. If you actually read Hegel, at least if you read the phenomenology or the logics, you won't find it quite so schematic. But if you read some of his other works, including his history of philosophy, you do sometimes see him falling into that. They're very schematic, and you know, history is a march of progress through time, up to the present time. So Shestov is reacting against a history of philosophy which is deeply informed by both of these sorts of notions. And another thing to keep in mind is that when Shestov is talking about the history of philosophy, I don't think he has in mind the sort of thing that I tend to mean by history of philosophy, which is actually trying to get to know the philosophers themselves on their own grounds, in terms of their own texts, using their own concepts to make sense of them, trying to reconstruct as best as possible not only a set of propositions that expresses their system or position, but their way of approaching things, their way of thinking about things, the spirit lying behind their texts, to enter into a sort of conversation with them. That's what I do in history of philosophy, but that's not what a lot of historians of philosophy do. Quite a few of them are interested in you know, categorizing when was this letter written and what was the context of this letter, and they stop short there. And they're content to sort of reconstruct in a somewhat external, spiritless way what the philosopher's position was and who they were reacting to and then who took them up later on. And that's about it. And it's felt that in the process, the life went out of the philosopher. So the histories about Plato, or secondary literature about Plato, is not quite the same thing as the experience of reading Plato for you know, your own sake, and engaging in dialogue within the dialogues with the thought that's there, engaging your own imagination, thinking things through, or doing this together with other people. The actual processes by which philosophers, you know, develop their ideas and then put them out there in the world and come to get known by other people tend to be rather idiosyncratic. And oftentimes their reception is completely contingent. So the history of philosophy, in a certain respect, falsifies what is its object, the philosophers and the act or action or practice of philosophizing that they're engaged in. And the history of philosophy oftentimes gives you this impression that it's all sort of like all on the same plane, everybody's got different ideas about different things, and they just came to different conclusions, or it's all building towards this kind of climax, or the, you know, there's these juncture points where everything changes and the whole system has to be rethought, and so after Kant we all have to think in a Kantian manner. But if we actually look at philosophers, if we get to know them, what we find out is, well, that's not really the case at all. You could actually be a great philosopher and never read Kant. And you could be a great philosopher and never read Shestov. You could be a great philosopher and never have read Thomas Aquinas. How do we know this? Well, there's this guy, you know, Plato. And this guy, Aristotle, and they were great philosophers, and they never read any of these people, and nor did they grapple with the exact problems that they grappled with or work in a post-Kantian framework, or et cetera, et cetera. We can go on forever about this sort of thing. But you could say, well, what about the present? You know, don't we have to take account of these different things that have happened in philosophy? You know, and Shestov would say, well, you do and you don't. I mean, that's your choice. if you are going to sort of accept the dogma, and it really is a dogma, that, you know, whatever way of doing philosophy that happens to be current here and present itself as what's popular or whatever it is that the journalists happen to run across in their intro to philosophy classes, you know, learning from their perhaps good professors or perhaps just, you know, raw green, just out of graduate school kids, whatever it is that one happens to think about philosophy, it's not something that necessarily imposes itself upon one. The model of philosophy that one deploys is really, in a large respect, up to oneself. And now, that doesn't mean that there aren't any consequences. If you say, well, I think philosophy means saying whatever I like, then everybody's free to come along and say you're full of it. If you, you know, pick up Schopenhauer and say, Schopenhauer solved everything, I'm never going to read anybody else, people are free to come along and say, well, you're a blockhead. If you, you know, were trained in analytic philosophy and you only read analytic philosophers, then, you know, you can take that as a model, but you're really missing out on a lot. Likewise, if all you do is read continental philosophy or classical American philosophy, and you can do that, you have the freedom to do that, but other people get to come along and say, well, there's much more dreamt of in heaven and earth than in your narrow philosophy. So Shestov is highlighting that. Theories of knowledge versus truth. One of the things that runs through this entire work that I'm going to talk about and try to highlight as often as I can is Shestov tells us a lot about his views on what truth is. And it turns out to be something that requires some work. It's an acquisition. It's not something that, you know, truth is not a property of propositions primarily, the way that a lot of people want to see it. Truth is something bigger. He has a robust conception of truth. So in this respect, he is like people like Augustine, or when Aristotle is getting away from his notion that truth is merely a matter of propositions in reality, which he does at certain points, that Aristotle, or Plato, or St. Anselm, and even to a certain extent when Thomas Aquinas can get away from his truth is only in the intellect kind of view, Thomas Aquinas. So this is quite important, and we'll hit on that. Now, why oppose theories of knowledge to that? Well, theories of knowledge, epistemology, or kentnis lera, this is what modern philosophy really centered itself around. And I don't just mean with people like, say, Descartes, or you may not think about this, but Hobbes did as well, or Locke, or, you know, Berkeley, people along those lines. I'm thinking even more about Hume and Kant, where Hume came along, and he did something that Shestov thinks is very important. He sort of made a good case for why we should be, to some degree, skeptical about claims about necessity, about things being absolute, about knowing reality in itself. And then Kant was troubled by these. He was broken out of his, as he said, dogmatic slumber. And he derived or developed a sort of comprehensive systematic response to that. And that's what's called the critical philosophy. The critical philosophy is a response to various forms of skepticism. And it's an attempt to try to put philosophy as best as one can on a solid footing and try to explain how it can be like, but not exactly the same thing as the sciences that were developing at the time, the sciences that people felt, well, at least this stuff is reliable. So a lot of people developed notions about you know, epistemology and what we could know and what constituted knowledge after Kant, and that, in large respect, is what we call the theories of knowledge. Deductions and teaching versus actual philosophy. Kant actually gives us a good example here. Shestov is going to say, and we'll come to this shortly, that Kant is one thing, and the interpretations that people make of Kant are a different thing. And Shestov will say that deductions from a philosophical position are not the same thing as the philosophical position. We'll see why in a moment. He also says that teaching and doing philosophy, there's a tension, a disconnect between them. Because when we teach, we sort of present things as if, well, it must be this way. And we try to boil everything down to the lowest common denominator so that we can, on the one hand, either like appeal to the crowd, well, it would be useful if we thought this way, or look, everybody else seems to get this. What's wrong with you, blockhead? You know, go sit over there in the corner to the student who simply says, I this doesn't make sense to me. Or we try to, that's an empirical approach, a utilitarian approach, or we try to sort of impose necessity upon them. And we say, it must be this way. Here's what the system looks like. Now learn this. And when we do that to Plato, and when we do that even to Aristotle, the actual philosophy kind of drops out of the picture. And as Shestov notes, the people who are actually doing philosophy, developing something new, tend not to be the best teachers. There's something about being a teacher which means kind of putting blinders on, or, you know, lowering yourself, as he'll say. So that's something kind of interesting to think about, given the fact that I'm teaching Shestov now. Now, there's a few quotations that, before we start going at this systematically, I want to bring up, because I really like these. And I think that these are very typically Shestovian. So one is in his discussion of truth as social substance. And he writes, one desires to know whether he does indeed possess the truth or whether he has only a universal error on his hands. What is to be done? I think there is a way. He should think to himself that it is absolutely impossible for his truth to be binding upon anybody. What he's doing here is he's giving you a criterion. He's saying, do a thought experiment. Use your imagination. Imagine to yourself that it's absolutely impossible for the truth that you know to be binding upon anybody. If in spite of this, he still refuses to renounce her, if the truth can suffer such an ordeal and yet remain the same to him as she was before, then it may be supposed that she was worth something. That tells you about the value of truth, about what is true. If you can accept that nobody else need accept it, and yet you will still recognize it as having the value that it has, that's a hallmark, Shestov thinks, for truth. A lot of other things are sort of truth mixed in with falsehoods. If we say, well, it works out great for society, or the experiments generally go the same way, you know, 99% of the people trying the experiment find that it actually works, which, by the way, wasn't the case in my high school chemistry class. It was usually about 50% of the times the experiments would work. And it's funny, because the experiments were there precisely to show us how science worked. But even, you know, 50%, you could say, well, look, you know, 50% of the time it works. That now I believe it's true. Shestov is saying, let yourself imagine that it never works, that it never has utility, that it never has practical value. Will you now renounce it? Will you now throw it away? Or is there something compelling about that that requires you to stick with it? Or not necessarily requires, because that sounds like necessity, that inclines you, that you can make a free response to and say, I will go along with this. Two other ones. He says, a moment comes, and he's talking about the operations that we perform on reality. A moment comes, only we cannot define it exactly, when explanations lose all meaning and are good for nothing anymore. It is though we are led by a rope, the law of sufficient reason, to a certain place and left there. Now go wherever you like. Then a little bit later, he says, there is a universal knowledge, which is the very object of philosophical seeking, with which one may commune, but which by its very essence cannot be communicated to all. That is, cannot be turned into verified and demonstrable universal truths. To renounce this knowledge in order that philosophy should have the right to be called a science. At times men acted thus. What we're doing in philosophy is not trying to derive explanations, interpretations, systems that we can measure by saying all rational beings must accept this. We have to actually be willing to say perhaps some, perhaps all the rest of the rational beings will not accept this, and yet it remains true. This is, again, where Shestov is so clearly an existentialist. Truth is personal. That doesn't mean that everything becomes relativized, subjectivized, it's all up for grabs. Again, because the relativists can't handle people coming up to them and saying, yeah, okay, you want to do that? Well, I think you're wrong. The relativist is insecure about people being able to call each other wrong. And of course, I'll have some relativists who will, you know, write in as a comment, no, we're not. Who are you to say that? But that just shows it all the more. Shestov is a pluralist. And the kind of pluralism that he's espousing is you know, a great expression of existentialism. There are some things that we can only get to know as true by involving ourselves, by choosing, by using our freedom to pursue these paths. And if we don't make that commitment, then we shouldn't, you know, sit back and say, well, that can't possibly be true, because that's only true from our vantage point because we didn't actually try it out. And if you only try it out halfway, if you only, you know, give a grudging acceptance to it, you're not really putting anything to an experiment. So, those are some of the key themes. Now we're going to look at each of these sets of passages bit by bit by bit, one at a time. Shestov's very first section of this essay is called The Theory of Knowledge as Apologetics. So, what is apologetics? Apologetics is a term that's often used in terms of religion and argument, and it comes out of essentially a Christian history of trying to provide reasoned arguments for the faith. So you could say that it includes natural theology as a project, and you can also say that it includes the early attempts to provide some sort of justification for why Christianity was the true religion, as opposed to, say, the ancient pagan religions. Augustine's City of God can be seen as, in certain respects, a text of apologetics. Apologetics tends to get a bad name, and I think rightfully so, because in many cases, apologetics ends up just looking around for whatever arguments it can, because it's already convinced that it's got the right position. Now we just need to find the arguments. And it tends to treat arguments, which are a part of the work of the mind and part of human inquiry, as if they're mere tools for producing conviction in other people. And if we understand apologetics in this way, then you can have religious apologetics, and you can also have anti-religious apologetics. People who've already decided ahead of time that the religious people must be crazy, must be wrong, and are just looking for arguments or whatever they can, and sometimes not even arguments, sometimes just facts, reason, you know, whatever they want to call it. They're doing the same sloppy, stupid work as the Christian who makes an argument that Christianity is true because it tends to hold a society together or something like that. It's all at the same low level. Now, what would the theory of knowledge be apologetics for? Shestov says, the theory of knowledge is apologetics for science, or rather, the sciences. And that's kind of a strange thing to say, particularly at his time when they were very optimistic about the capacities of science. He says, the modern theory of knowledge, although it always consciously takes its rise from Kant, has in one respect quite disregarded the master's commandment. Kant undertook to investigate our cognitive faculties in order to establish foundations in virtue of which certain existing sciences could be accepted, others rejected. So, you know, for example, astronomy could be accepted, astrology could be rejected. And then Kant wanted to subject philosophy itself in its traditional activities like metaphysics or like ethics to this as well. And he says, one may say that the second purpose was chief. That is, having the sciences be accepted and others rejected. Hume's skepticism made him uneasy only in theory. He knew beforehand that whatever theory of knowledge he might invent, mathematics and the natural sciences would remain sciences and metaphysics be rejected. So Kant, according to Shestov, already sort of has in mind what he wants to come out of his theory of knowledge. Some things are going to be able to be knowledge, other things are not going to be able to be knowledge. Now, of course, Kant reserves for some of these things, you know, for example, ethics or moral philosophy, and to a certain extent metaphysics, some sort of province out there in the noumenal world of the thing in itself, but we can't really know much about that. We certainly can't have any knowledge in a scientific way about that. And then he says, but now the position is different. The theorists of knowledge direct all their efforts towards justifying. That is, apologetics is about justification. It comes out of a sense of doubt or insecurity. And he says, they're aiming at justifying scientific knowledge. Why? Does scientific knowledge really require justification? And he says, I mean, there's kooks like Tolstoy, and now Shestov is kind of playing, you know, around here. He doesn't think that Shestov is, or that Tolstoy is terrible. He writes books about him. He says they attack science, but their attacks offend no one, nor do they cause alarm. Scientists continue on with their work. The universities flourish. Discoveries follow discovery. And the theorists of knowledge themselves do not spend sleepless nights in the endeavor to find new justifications for science. So what's going on? And now think ahead to our own time. Most people are pretty confident about science. And they may reject some things. You know, some people, you know, are wary of vaccines, but that doesn't mean that they're not going to use technology to get on Facebook and talk about that. And that's as much a part or much a product of science as anything else. And people are very selective about, you know, what studies that they will use to back up the position that they want. So they all are accepting science to a certain degree. And many people are totally untroubled about science or the sciences. They, you know, so long as there's an experiment, they'll swallow just about anything that you can put as a conclusion. So, he says, what are these theorists doing then? He says, the modern theory of knowledge is no longer a science, but an apology, and its demonstrations are like those of apology. Once science must be defended, it is necessary to begin by what? Praising her, by selecting evidence and data to show that science fulfills some mission or other, but indubitably a very high and important one, or on the other hand, by painting a picture of the fate that would overtake mankind if it was deprived of science. And you can see the same thing going on today when people are making claims like, science can reveal to us what morality itself is. Just asinine claims at face value. Science can actually make some interesting contributions, but science per se cannot tell us much about morality or about even language, can't tell us that much about the human psyche. These are much more, you know, involved and intricate things than the methods of science and its frameworks and assumptions can actually get to. And science tends to, now this has been going on for quite a while, science, just like reason, tends to create a lot of boogeymen very often out of the past. You know, if we defund scientific research of this, the Inquisition is going to come. And not only is that terrible history, usually the people who talk about that have no idea whatsoever what the Inquisition was, other than it was a bad thing, and people were anti-knowledge in it. The Inquisition was localized here and here and here, and there were people within it who would say, hey, this nonsense has got to stop. The picture is always a lot more complicated than the kind of demonization of opponents that goes on. And that's always a sign that there's some deep insecurity lurking in the background. I'm not bashing science, by the way. Neither is Shestov. What he is attacking are the people who are pushing science, pushing a sort of scientism or scientificism, it gets called sometimes, this notion that science has the keys and clues to everything. And when you make those sort of claims, which are overblown, you inevitably have to engage in some apologetics. So he says, it's plain not as all is well with science because she's already begun to justify herself. Besides, apologetics are only apologetics, and sooner or later the theory of knowledge will be tired of psalms of praise and will demand a more complex and responsible task and a real labor. At present, the theorists start with the assumption that scientific knowledge is perfect knowledge, and therefore the premises on which it is builded are not subject to criticism. The law of causation is not justified because it appears to be the expression of a real relation of things, nor even because we have data at our disposal which could convince us it does not and will not ever admit exceptions, that uncaused effects are impossible. All these things are lacking, but we're told they're not needed. Just have faith. Not faith, because that sounds religious. You just have to accept these postulates, i.e. have faith. He says, the chief thing is that the causal law makes science possible. Well, to reject it means to reject science and knowledge generally, all anticipation and even, as some few hold, reason itself. Clearly, if you have to decide, he says, between the whole world going to crap because you can't predict anything anymore and believing in what science purports itself to be, it sounds a lot better to do that, to do the second. He says, these arguments partake of one common defect. They're not constant and they're double-edged. Today they defend scientific knowledge. Tomorrow they will attack it. And if you read on here, he's sort of prefiguring what we call postmodernism, which is very suspicious about the grounds upon which science has built itself. And that is something that comes out of science itself. This inquisitive attitude, as Nietzsche called it, the will to truth. There's a certain corrosiveness in that prevents you from being able to engage in apologetics. Let's go on. He's got this next section called Truth and Utility, and this is very short. And he talks about John Stuart Mill, and he's not talking about him in terms of utilitarianism, on liberty. He's talking about his sort of his logical works. Mill tried to reduce everything to an empiricism. And Mill tried to prove that sciences all were empirical in origin. And he says, if on every occasion we had to take twice two things, we had to add up 2 plus 2, and some god slipped one extra thing into our hands, we would be convinced that 2 times 2, or 2 plus 2, is not 4 but 5. Perhaps Mill is right. Perhaps we would not figure out what is the matter. We're much more concerned to discover what's practically necessary and directly useful to us than to search for truth. This is a constant and common problem throughout all history, and it poses an even greater issue in this time when we are just surrounded and even to a certain extent permeated by technology. What's useful is not always what's true. Or what is useful may contain a certain amount of truth, but only so far. But it purports itself to represent the entirety of it. So he says, once the law of uniformity is established, no one is interested in anything anymore. Now we can foretell the future. Now we can use the things slipped into our hands. Don't worry about the rest. That's the slippage from a sort of a careful attitude about knowledge and science towards a careless. The next section, he switches gears a bit. It's called Philosophers and Teachers. And he says, everyone knows Schopenhauer was for many years not only not recognized, but not even read. His books were used for waste waste paper. It was only towards the end of his life he had readers, admirers, and of course, critics. And so this leads us to an interesting point. And it doesn't necessarily have to apply just to Schopenhauer or to philosophers who are not read for a while, who take a while to catch on. You have the philosopher and the philosopher develops a philosophy and then it sort of catches on. And you have students. And those students eventually become their own, you know, teachers and will teach other students. And now the philosopher gets mediated through teachers. And if the philosopher is still alive, he or she gets called upon to actually function as a teacher and explain away all the contradictions or to address all of the possible criticisms of their work. And so Schopenhauer gives us a nice case in point here. He says, Schopenhauer did not have the experience of being a master till his old age. At first behaved very benevolently to his disciples' questions and patiently gave the explanations required. So he's trying to address that. But the further one goes into the forest, the thicker are the trees. The most loyal perplexities of his pupils became more and more importunate until at last the old man lost patience. I didn't undertake to explain all the secrets of the universe to everyone who wanted to know them, he exclaimed, when a certain pupil persisted in emphasizing the contradictions he had noticed in Schopenhauer. And so Shestov, you know, he could go one way with this. The way that he could go is to say, ah, see, charlatan. He's a faker. He can't actually justify his own position. Push any philosopher far enough and you're going to find these contradictions. And that means, and then they're not going to be able to stand up to them. And that means it's all BS. Shestov doesn't say that. Instead, what does he argue? He says, is a master obliged to explain everything? That's a good question. Is a master, is a creator, is somebody who's actually further along the path required to explain everything to students, to make everything conform to some sort of logic or system? Shestov says no. As a matter of fact, that's poisonous to the very work that they're doing. He says, a philosopher not only cannot be a teacher, he does not want to be one. There are teachers in universities, in schools. They teach arithmetic, grammar, logic, metaphysics. The philosopher has a different task, one which does not in the least resemble teaching. So that's what we want to know about then. What is this task? The philosopher is the one who takes risks. He's sort of not even the entrepreneur, because there's not a great return on investment in terms of things that other people would recognize. The philosopher is the adventurer. The philosopher is the explorer who wants to know what lies beyond and to try to grapple with it and make it his own. And then he comes back and he tries to communicate what he can of it. Now, the next section brings up some of this stuff. It's called Truth as a Social Substance. And he says, there are many ways, real and imaginary, of objectively verifying philosophical opinions. That's an interesting thing to think about, objectively verifying. So, you know, we can think of this over here, you know, to verify. Trust but verify was the model in the Reagan years about the Soviets. And rightly so, as it turns out, once we actually looked at their documents. But verification in philosophy, how does that play out? He says, all of these ways ultimately boil down to trial by the law of contradiction. And then he says, true, everyone is aware that no single philosophic doctrine is able to support such a trial, so that pending a better future, people consider it possible to display a certain tenderness in the examination. They're usually satisfied if they come to the conclusion that the philosopher made a genuine attempt to avoid contradictions. So, you know, if you come up with some great idea, or you've got some thing that is, you know, of the times and people can identify with it, then they'll forgive you for that. And you might even have several great ideas, you know, Descartes with the doubt everything, and the mind-body separation and the evil genius. Which, the evil genius, by the way, doesn't play a major role in Descartes' actual philosophy, but it captured people's attention. And if you plumb through Descartes, you're going to find contradictions, and you're going to find things you can criticize. With Kant, who is, you know, absolutely concerned to avoid that sort of stuff, you can find that in his. One prime example, which I'm still, you know, thinking about and writing about, his discussions of the faculty of desire. I have never found anybody who could actually make successfully heads or tails of that. I've seen people write about it, but when you unravel it, you're left in the end with stuff that you're like, he means that? What the hell is this? The question then is, what do we do? Do we say, aha, bunch of charlatans. None of them can withstand it. No. Shestov says we only do that in the cases of the ones that we don't like. We're selective with this. So, you know, again, if we want to think about atheists and Christians and these polemics that you see played out on YouTube and on all these blogs and comments and stuff like that, I would say that a good 95% of the stuff consists of people who are being uncharitable towards the other side and far too charitable towards their own side. Just because, you know, Augustine is a Christian doesn't mean that you necessarily want to accept his philosophical views on things if you're a Christian. Just because he is a Christian, simply because you're an atheist and you don't like Christians, doesn't mean that you shouldn't actually read Augustine all the way to the bottom to see if the guy was onto something. That you should, you know, find the easiest cheap shot contradiction that you can, perhaps not even digging into the ideas, just going for the surface level and say, aha, got him, now I can throw him away. That's really doing sloppy philosophical work. And it's getting away from what it means to actually be a philosopher. So he says, strictly speaking, we have to confess we have no real objective method of verifying a philosophical truth. When we criticize other people's systems, we judge arbitrarily. If a philosopher suits us for some reason, we don't trouble him with the law of contradiction. If he does not, we summon him before the court to be judged with the utmost rigor of the law. But sometimes there arises the desire to verify one's own philosophical convictions. That's a problem. There's other people, and we say, well, you know, you kind of pay your money and take your chances. You pick who you want to go with for whatever reasons. Understanding that, but other people can still criticize you for that. But what about your own philosophical convictions? How do you verify them? He says, to play the farce of objective verification with them, to look for contradictions in oneself. I don't suppose even Germans are capable of that. And yet one desires to know whether he does indeed possess the truth or only has a universal error on his hands. This is where Shestov recommends that test or criterion of truth that I was mentioning earlier, where that same passage comes up, where he says, imagine that the truth that you have is not binding upon anybody else. Do you still want to keep it? If you do, then you're good. If not, then maybe you should consider it. Let's go on to the next section. He talks about doctrines and deductions. And here, what we're dealing with, again, we have the philosopher. And the philosopher comes up with some sort of systematic approach to things. Let's call it, you know, doctrines, system, and the question is, well, is this actually true or false or right or wrong? This is the product that they provide us with. And, you know, if you think about just for a moment so that you can wrap your head around this the way that Shestov wants you to, I think. Where would this consist? Where would you find this for Plato? It would be in the dialogues and perhaps in some of the letters. You know, if you think about the seventh letter and the impact that that has on interpreting Plato's work. if you think about Kant, the three critiques, some of the other works, in particular the Prolegomena and the Groundwork, and then the Metaphysics of Morals, rounded out, I suppose, with the Anthropology. With Hegel, the Phenomenology, coupled with the two Logics, perhaps. I mean, we could go on and on and on from this. If Cicero has something like this, it's going to be spread out throughout his dialogues. With Aristotle, you have the whole corpus there. Thomas Aquinas, where should we go? Should we go straight to the Summa Theologia, or do we have to look in some of the other works? This is stuff we want to consider, stuff that's worth thinking about. In any case, we have the doctrines, and he says, if you want to ruin a new idea, try to give it the widest possible publicity. So publicity, the public, plays a role in this. And now think about what goes on when you're trying to make sense out of Plato. Can you apply Plato directly to the world? Can you teach and say, look, we're just going to read the dialogue, now what do you make of it? Or do we come up with handouts? I mean, think about what I do in my own teaching videos. When I have my students or the core concept videos, I say, well, here's an idea. Now we're going to kind of abstract this out, and then we're going to look at some examples of how this would play out in our own lives today. I'm really, in effect, doing what Shestov is criticizing here, which is drawing deductions. And deductions are the way in which the system, the philosopher, their thought, makes its way to the public, to the world as such. And he says, you know, if you want to ruin a new idea, this is the way to do it. To interpret it. Men will begin to reflect on it, to try by their daily needs to interpret it, to make deductions from it, in a word, to squeeze it into their own prepared logical apparatuses. So the problem is that this process is not something without presuppositions. There's already some sort of viewpoint, some sort of needs, some sort of concerns, and we're going to force everything in here, sort of like in the fairy tale, the sisters trying to force their foot into Cinderella's slipper. In the Disney one, it just doesn't work. In the old Grimm's one, they hack off their heels to try to get it in there. And the Grimm is always much more true than the Disney, even though we're talking about fables in both cases. That's what happens with important ideas. You know, if Plato's Symposium, which I just taught this last semester, if that is something that we have to try to fit into the criteria and concerns and the time schedule of the average 18-year-old kid, we're probably leaving an awful lot of Plato out in the process. And what we're not leaving out is probably getting transformed. You know, think of a body, cut a hand off of it. It's, as Aristotle says, really not a hand anymore, except in name. So he says, the majority of philosophical systems are chaotically and obscurely expounded so that not every educated person can understand them. It's a pity to kill one's own child, and everyone does his best to save it from premature death. The most dangerous enemies of an idea are deductions from it, as though they followed of themselves. The idea does not presuppose them. They are usually pressed upon it. So what's going on here is actually, on the one hand, choice, and on the other hand, assumptions and a system. The philosopher's ideas are forced into the confines of the system, and that's the choice of the people who are actually doing this. And he says, people often say the idea is quite right, but it leads to conclusions which are not at all acceptable. Again, how often is a philosopher to attend the sad spectacle of his pupils deserting all his ideas and only feeding on the conclusions from them? Every thinker who's had the misfortune to attract attention while he was yet alive knows by bitter experience what deductions are. And yet, he says, you'll rarely find a philosopher who has the courage to resist this popularization, this becoming becoming a person who matters, becoming a public philosopher, becoming a bestseller, becoming well-known, getting to go on the talk show circuit, or the lecture circuit at that time, And he says the only answer is an appeal to the popular verdict. Well, let me back up a little bit. He says, what you could do, if you want to present resistance to this, is to say outright that your work needs no continuation, that it exists only in and for itself, that it's self-sufficient. And if you do this, then they can't get you, for the most part. Because, like he says, if you're not going to argue with them, what can they do? Aristotle pointed this out a long time ago. Somebody who simply won't argue, defend a position, there's nothing you can do. So if you cut them off there and say, yeah, not here to teach you. This is just for my own consumption and the consumption of those who actually are worthy of it. Well, then the answer to that is an appeal to the popular verdict, to Lynch law. He says, people are so weak and naive, they will let Kaas see a teacher in every philosopher. In other words, they want to throw upon him the responsibility for their actions. They want to avoid seeing that they are making choices to draw those deductions and not other deductions. They want to cast that back upon the thinker and make them into a teacher. And like he points out, Socrates is not executed for being a teacher. There were plenty of teachers in Athens. He was executed for teaching things that people thought that ought not to be taught. And, whether he did or not, that's a debatable question. And then he says, one of the greatest teachings, Christianity, was also persecuted because it seemed dangerous to the self-appointed guardians, or if you will, because it was really dangerous to Roman ideals. And he says, of course, neither Socrates' death nor the deaths of thousands of the early Christians saved the ancient culture and polity from decay, but nobody's learned anything from the lesson. And so like he says, What can we draw from this? Many, the vast majority, are convinced that philosophy is the most tedious and painful occupation of which are doomed some miserable wretches who enjoy the odious privilege of being called philosophers. I believe even professors of philosophy, the more clever of them, not seldom share this opinion, and suppose therein lies the ultimate secret of their science to be revealed to the initiate alone. Fortunately, the position is otherwise, Shestov says. It may be that mankind is never going to change in this, but to do philosophy is actually to embark upon a voyage of discovery and to bring back what one can, not necessarily all of the world that one finds there. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit here. He says, I'm going to go into the next section. Truths proven and unproven. He says, whence did we get the habit of requiring proofs of each idea that is expressed? Why did we get this notion that every single position that a person puts out has to be, in some respect, defended? And you can see this all the more on the sort of forums that we find, for example, with YouTube. I can't count how many times I've had somebody who saw some video of mine where I was talking about a philosopher, and I try to present each philosopher's point of view as fairly and as charitably as I can. So when I'm presenting Ayn Rand, I talk about Rand as if I was a Randian. When I'm presenting Kant, who Rand hated, I present Kant as if I was a Kantian. When I present Plato, who I love more than Kant, definitely, I present Plato as a Platonist. And when I finally get to Aristotle, who I like more than all of the rest of them, by the way, I think Rand got Aristotle wrong, then I get to actually turn it on. But there are some things where I don't agree with Aristotle, but I'll present it as Aristotle's view. And I have people who write in comments, and they want to get in arguments and demand justification for this, and justification for this, and justification for this. And at a certain point, you're like, look, buddy, I don't have the time to engage in this, because I'm shooting videos, right? The stuff that you're actually getting worked up about. But even if I did have the time, this is fruitless. You're making claims about what this person is saying that are so tendentious, so off base. How the hell would I answer them? It would take me work upon work upon work to actually get you to see where this is going wrong. But that's the modern tendency. That's the mass tendency. Again, existentialist themes. Where did we get this idea that everything has to be called upon and justified? That we get to call everybody on the carpet? He says, if we put aside the consideration that men do often purposely deceive other people, that this happens, then, strictly speaking, the necessity for proof is entirely removed. It's true that we can deceive ourselves and fall into involuntary error. Sometimes we make mistakes that way, but as soon as the possibility of bona fide error, good faith error, is removed, then we may relate simply without arguments, judgments, or references. If you please, believe. If you don't, don't. So he says, we've been taught that what cannot be proved should not be spoken about. That somehow, and again, this is very typically modern, unless you can provide a foundation, a justification that other people find acceptable for it, shut up. You don't get to think about it. You don't get to talk about it. Now, why would we have such an oppressive way of looking at things? And why would we allow that to be done to ourselves? And why would we then do that to ourselves reflexively? He talks about this in terms of metaphysics. He says, perhaps this is the reason why metaphysics has been the object of incessant attack. Metaphysics was not only unable to find a form of expression for her truths, which would free her from the obligation of proof, she didn't even want to. She considered herself the science par excellence, and therefore supposed she had more largely and more strictly to prove the judgments that she took under her wing. So we have metaphysics. Not writing very well today. Metaphysics as a discipline decided that it had to provide proof. Whoa. Foundations. It didn't really need to. There was no internal necessity for that. And so she said she thought if she were to neglect the duty of demonstration, she would lose all of her rights. So what this is about is rights. And rights come precisely by providing proof or foundations. It's sort of like you have to show your ID card. You have to prove who you are. You have to justify yourself. Guilty until proven innocent. That is the modern way of looking at things. You know, apart from the innocent until proven guilty in the court of law, modernity has been in large part a sort of shifting of burdens of proof away from what was traditional and saying, aha, you have to justify yourself. The mere fact that you've existed for a while means you're brought into the docket and you're probably doing something nefarious. This whole critical attitude towards things. Everything must justify itself. Metaphysics bought into that. And it says, that was your fatal mistake. The correspondence of rights and duties is perhaps a cardinal truth or cardinal fiction of the doctrine of law, but it's been introduced into the sphere of philosophy by a misunderstanding. Here, the contrary principle is enthroned. Rights are in inverse proportion to duties. Only where all duties have ceased is there the greatest and most sovereign right acquired, the right of communion with ultimate truths. And now notice, he doesn't say ultimate truth, he says ultimate truths. Plural. And because Shestov is a pluralist, he says, we must not forget one moment that ultimate truths have nothing in common with middle truths, the logical construction of which we've so diligently studied for the last 2,000 years. The fundamental difference is that the ultimate truths are absolutely unintelligible, Unintelligible, I repeat, but not inaccessible. This demand for proof, this demand for not just proof, but communication, this making the man on the street, the lowest common denominator, the student that could have this explained to, or the stupid professor who is barely one step above a student and never actually learned their discipline or any joy in it. They are not the criteria for whether we're in touch with ultimate truths. Ultimate truths cannot be made fully intelligible, but that doesn't mean that they're inaccessible. So he says, we've gotten ourselves into the habit of thinking that you know, intelligibility, the ability to make something understandable to any other given person, regardless of what their background is, regardless of what their commitment is somehow the test for whether we're actually accessing something real, whether we're undergoing something transformative, whether we're on the right track. That was a mistake to make, he thinks. He goes on and he talks a little bit about how oftentimes the revelations or the connections that we have with these ultimate truths are only for a moment. We have to be ready to seize them when they come. And yet they can pervade the entirety of our life. He gives the example of Dostoevsky and paradise. Dostoevsky himself entered paradise for only an instant. But how could paradise be proven? How could one fix, how express those half seconds of paradisic beatitude? How do you actually bring that across? Well, you don't. That's the point. So we've journeyed through quite a bit. Now I'm actually going to start looking at some of the other ones. And we've gone sort of up the hill. Now we're going to slowly come back down. The last seven passages or portions of the theory of knowledge, which I'm going to go through a bit quicker than I have the previous seven, are all concerned with a central problematic. And we saw this question of ultimate truths come up before, and the question is, how does the philosopher, or indeed how do we, if we, you know, whether we're philosophers or not, how do we get to these ultimate truths? And there's a lot of candidates proposed to us by the theory of knowledge, by certain deductive, interpretive stances on philosophies, by the history of philosophy itself, by philosophy as practiced and dissected by university professors and desiccated into essentially a mummy of itself. And these are some of the, you know, big candidates. So we're going to go through this, and we're going to try to see, can any of these give us what we want? Or does the philosopher get to it by something else instead? So he's got this discussion, the limits of reality, and he says, after all, not even the most consistent and convinced realist represents life to himself as it really is. He overlooks a great deal. And on the other hand, he often sees something which has no existence in reality. We are all, whether we talk in terms of realism or not, of, you know, looking things straight in the face. And another thing people often like to use, facts. I only look at facts. I don't make, you know, value judgments. Utter nonsense. What makes anybody think that they somehow are more attuned to the facts of life than Plato was, or Spinoza, or Schopenhauer, or Hegel, or Kant, or Shestov? It's kind of hubristic, actually. It's a hubrism of the humble, to elevate oneself. It's really a kind of a form of what Nietzsche called ressentiment, to do that. And he says, for all our desire to be objective, we are, after all, extremely subjective. And those things which Kant calls synthetic judgments a priori, by which our mind forms nature and dictates law to her, do play a great and serious part in our lives. So maybe this is something that we actually need to keep there. And he goes on and he says, when one has to choose between philosophy, which is alluring and promising, and empty logic, one will always sacrifice the latter for the former. And philosophy without contradictory judgments would be doomed to eternal silence, or would be churned into a mud of commonplace and reduced to nothing. Philosophers know that. The same is true of our own case. We must confess we are at the same time awake and dreaming dreams. We must, at times we must own that though we are alive, yet we have long since been dead. We have been dead, sorry. And he goes on, I'm going to skip through the rest of this section. I'm going to talk about the given and the possible, because now he talks about necessity and causation. So the law of causation as a principle of inquiry is an excellent thing. The existing sciences offer us convincing evidence of that. And that holds even the more in our own time, you know, when you think about the massive advances that we are experiencing over and over again through not only sciences but technology. But is the law of causation something that is absolute, from which there is no appeal, no escape? Or does it apply only to certain portions of reality? Is it even out of place in others? He says, some philosophers actually have thought that we have to extend it to everything. He brings up Goethe and Spinoza, you know, and this ultimate harmony. Spinoza was a complete determinist and thought that you know, you had to do that in order to actually think philosophically. He goes on and he says, the law of causation, like the whole harmony of the world, seems to Spinoza a pleasant gift, facilitating life, but yet a degrading one. He has sold his birthright for peace, for undisturbed happiness, his great birthright of free creation. He says, strangely, nature herself seems to be preoccupied in urging man to that fateful path. There comes a time in our life when some imperative and secret voice forbids us to rejoice at the beauty and grandeur of the world, where we think there must be something beyond this. There must be something greater. And, you know, real scientists are fascinated by the things that they're studying. They, you know, the law of causation is a way to sort of get into them. But these are not going to get us to ultimate truths. What will? Freedom. Our exercise of the faculty of choice, which we have, is an integral part of making our way towards ultimate truths. Let's go on to experiment and proof. And he talks about Descartes and Nietzsche and several other people here, some of their guiding ideas, and about how impressed they were when they had these ideas. And he says, one might name many philosophers, poets, artists, preachers who, like these three, suddenly saw the light and considered their vision the beginning of a new life. So something cracks open, some new idea. And whatever necessity, whatever, you know, causation was there in place, it wedges it open and says, no, there's something more going on here. Intelligibility is not confined to what Nietzsche made of it, what Kant made of it, or what Hegel made of it. Or, you know, I suppose if you want to reject Nietzsche, even what Nietzsche made of it. There's some dogmatic Nietzscheans who are probably worth rejecting. And he says, though much is spoken of these miracles and often in nearly all the biographies of great men, we cannot strictly make any use of them. Descartes, Schelling, Nietzsche tell us the story of their conversion, and with us, Tolstoy and Dostoevsky tell of theirs. In the less remote past, there are Muhammad and Paul the Apostle, and far antiquity, the legend of Moses. But if I had chosen tenfold the number of thousands even had been collected, it would still be impossible for the mind to make any deduction from them. You can't, now notice that term deduction again. You can't say, I'm going to go and just, I'm going to be Plato again, or I'm going to be Nietzsche again. These new ideas are not things that we can simply draw deductions from. They challenge us. We choke on them, so to speak. That's not the term Shestov uses, but I would say that's an experience on my part. And he says, it's impossible to fix them as indubitable facts, for facts also require verification and must be proved. There are no proofs, philosophical and religious teachings offered by men who have had extraordinary inward experiences not only do not generally confirm, but rather refute their own stories of revelation. And he goes on and talks about, you know, can these all be possible? And, you know, can we rely on other people's, the fruits of other people's experiences that bring about these new ideas? He says, yes, and we can do that even though there will be frauds. There will be people who are coming along and saying, aha, I've got a new great idea. And it turns out to be just fine-spun nonsense. Let's go on to the next section, the seventh day of creation. He's talking about Socrates here, and he says that Socrates at least thought that the poets were divinely inspired. They couldn't make heads or tails of what they were doing, and so they couldn't satisfy the Platonic demand for knowledge, which had to be able to give an account of it. But the poets were at least in touch with the divine. And he says, Socrates thought that not merely poets, but all men had ideas, even a great many ideas, but they could never explain where they'd gotten them or make them agree among themselves. And for Socrates, this seemed a real misery, a misfortune, like he says. I don't know how it happened, but Socrates, for some reason, decided that an unproven and unexplained truth had less value than a proven and explained one. In our times, when a whole theory, even a conception of the world, has been made of Socrates' ideas, this seems natural and self-evident to us. But in antiquity, the case was different. So he goes on and he says, Socrates believed that the poets were divinely inspired, that they were getting their what was passing for knowledge from some good source. And then he says, is it not strange that under such circumstances, at an epoch when the gods vouchsafed truths to men, when you could get that through revelation, there should have suddenly appeared in a man the unexplained desire to acquire truths without the help of the gods and in independence of them by the dialectic method so beloved of the Greeks. It's doubtful which is more important for us, to acquire the truth or to acquire for one's self with one's own effort. It may be a false, but one's own judgment. And then he brings up the biblical story of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And he says, Adam didn't have to pick from that. He could have gotten anything he wanted from God. He could have gotten the answers to anything. But he wanted it for himself. That's part of what's going on behind the scenes. That's part of what's driving the philosopher to come up with new ideas that are supposed to somehow get towards ultimate truths. But that's also what's going on with the entire theory of knowledge. We want to have it for ourselves. We want to have something where we can say, screw you, reality, screw you, God, screw you, other people who I don't like. This I can rest on, and this I can know for certain. This I can have proofs of. But it's a very sterile way to live. And he says, Socrates renounced the divine truth and even spoke contemptuously of it, merely because it was not proven. That is, because it does not bear the marks of man's handiwork. The theory of knowledge is, at its heart, an attempt not to... It's a way to use our freedom to subject ourselves to some sort of necessity. And it's a weird mixture of autonomy and heteronomy at the same time, Shestov would say. Let's go on. He talks about what does the history of philosophy teach us? What it does teach us is that these new ideas are going to be quite different from each other, and they can do that. Like he says, here we go. If you analyze the colossal mass that's been written on Kant and put the question to yourself, what's really been left to us of Kant's teaching, you'll have to reply, nothing at all. You can take interpretations and deductions from any of these people, and you're going to lose that new idea. says the same can be said of all the great representatives of philosophic thought. Their works astonish by their power, depth, boldness, beauty, and originality of thought. When you read them, it seems that truth herself speaks with their lips, and what strong measures of precaution did they take to prevent themselves from being mistaken? They methodically doubted everything, re-examined everything tens, hundreds of times. They gave their life to the truth, not in words, but in deed. So another thing that's required here is a sort of commitment, or let's call it risk, taking chances. That's hard to bring into the history of philosophy. The history of philosophy tends to be a matter of interpretations and deductions. Let's go on. He talks about Spencer and never reading Kant and what would come about if he would have read Kant. And I'm actually going to go over that. His main position there is if he had indeed read Kant, he would have figured out that why he actually disagreed with him. But many of the neo-Kantians are actually doing worse than Spencer. They're sort of distorting what Kant, who was a great thinker in this respect as well, had made of things. Spencer is sort of a mediocre thinker who almost nobody reads anymore, but was a big important guy in his own time, a bestseller. And he himself, tries to appeal to other things, to try to get to ultimate truths, but fails. Let's go on to this this next section. A tacit assumption, he talks about Schopenhauer and questioning the value of life. And here's where the real meat of this is. He's got an interesting discussion of Schopenhauer, which I have to skip over here. And he says, the question of the value of life is not at all decided by whether in the sum life gives more joy than pain or vice versa. Why? Well, because it's possible to come up with multiple answers about the question of life. He says, to one man, the eudaimonistic point of view, the view that life is about happiness, is ultimate and decisive. To another, contemptible and degrading, and he seeks the meaning of life in a higher ethical or aesthetic purpose. There are also people who love the sorrow and pain and see in them the justification, source of depth, and importance of life. So there's three positions already. Nor do I mention the fact that when the sum totals of life are reckoned, different accountants reach different and directly contradictory results, or that the insoluble questions arise concerning these or other details. So what is it? He says, people are looking at this question about the value of life in different ways. If you are asked what is life, good or evil, you're obliged to say life is both good and evil, something independent of good and evil, or a mixture of good and evil in which there's more good than evil or more evil than good. And then Shestov says, I repeat, each of these answers, although they logically quite exclude each other, has the right to claim the title of truth. For if it has not power enough to make the other answers bow down before it, as would be the case if it was necessity or something like that, it has the necessary strength to repel its opponent's attacks and to defend its sovereign rights. You can make a way of living out of it. It can be a coherent approach to thinking, to acting, to choosing, to relating oneself to others. He says, instead of a sole and omnipotent truth before which the weak and helpless errors tremble, you have before you a whole line of perfectly independent truths, excellently armed and defended. Instead of absolutism, you have a feudal system. And the vassals are so firmly ensconced in their castles that any experienced eye can see that they are impregnable. So you can choose which of these that you're going to go with. You can choose to follow Plato. You can choose to follow Augustine. You can choose to follow Heidegger, for that matter. And he says, Aristotle, it's okay for Aristotle to differ from Plato. That doesn't mean that the history of philosophy somehow is just the history of errors. Instead, where did the history of philosophy go wrong, he says. Although they never speak of it, philosophers value their own personal convictions much more highly than universally valid truth, that is, a truth that everybody would accept. The impossibility of discovering one sole philosophic truth may alarm anyone but the philosophers themselves, who, so soon as they've worked out their own convictions, take not the smallest trouble to secure general recognition for them. They're only busy with getting rid of their vassal dependence and acquiring sovereign rights for themselves. Beautiful feudal metaphor there. So when it comes to these ultimate truths, we take on some of these, and we don't need to take on all of these, nor do we have to try to reduce them all to one. He says, the history of philosophy should be so expounded that this tendency should be clearly manifest. So when we're teaching Aristotle, we should teach Aristotle as if Aristotle is actually onto something. And we don't, that doesn't mean that we have to say everything must bow down to Aristotle and be brought under Aristotle, or else it is an error and wrong and terrible and vicious and we must destroy it. It's not absolutist in that way. But we can recognize that Aristotle provides us with a way to get at these, a way to live these out. And his way can differ from Plato. And Plato can also be right. Why? Well, because where is truth actually experienced? It's experienced in life, freedom, commitment, risk, activity. These are the ways that we actually experience and live out truth and grow in relation to it. The history of philosophy, Shestov is saying, that's what it should be representing. He says, Kant, who shared the opinion that truth is the same for all, was convinced that metaphysics must be a science a priori, and since it cannot be a science a priori, must therefore cease to exist. If the history of philosophy had been expounded and understood differently in his day, it would have never entered his mind to thus impugn the rights of metaphysics. And probably he would not have been vexed by the contradictoriness or the lack of proof in the teachings of various schools of metaphysics. It cannot be otherwise, neither should it be. The interest of mankind is not to put an end to the variety of philosophical doctrines, but to allow the perfectly natural phenomena wide and deep development. Philosophers have had an instinctive longing for this. That is why they are so troublesome to the historian of philosophy. And that is actually where I'm going to end, because that's a perfect capstone for this. Shestov himself is a prime example of this. Look what he's doing with these other philosophers. Look what he is making of them. He is probing into their thoughts. He's willing to see where they actually are onto something. He's willing to try out their way, try out their viewpoint, try out their perspective. He's even willing to go so far as to be charitable to what appear to be contradictions or points where you can criticize their works. That's what Shestov is advocating as a kind of pluralism. Now, what does this mean for those of us who perhaps are not philosophers? We still need to behave like philosophers, because we still have to answer these great fundamental questions like, what the hell am I doing here? What's this all about? How should I act? How should I, you know, structure my life? These eminently practical questions. And the answers to them, Shestov thinks, are going to be found by something, at least for those who venture on it, like the process of philosophy.